Okay, so far we have seen only binary interpolations, binary morphological interpolations, and I called that the missing snapshot and how we are inserting is I call it as a median element.
It's a grayscale morphology and interpolation used in where suppose in a grayscale image a strip line is there, strip is there and value is missing or information is missing. In that case, can it be used?
You mean within the data
suppose
there are missing values?
Specifically, for example, in MSS data, let's say MSS data, there is a strip.
Yes.
In every data, there are some strips for scan error or something.
Okay.
Error.
Okay.
In that case, can it be used?
No, that doesn't require this computationally expensive process.
Yeah, there are some procedures. I'm saying.
But I think so. If you do some simple one dilation and one erosion, and such streaks will be lost. Yeah.
Okay.
So such streaks are mostly artifacts, or we call them as spurious information, which would. Which wouldn't give us a the good visual appeal, and we know that it is spurious or noisy, and such things. And with simple one erosion followed by one dilation, that will be lost. Yeah, yeah. Such things we don't need to go for such expensive methods. So even if I suggest, okay, you can go for grayscale morphology, and the people may. Eventually, I tell you that oh, you have misused mathematics unnecessarily. Like that, they say it's not required. Okay, this morphological grayscale morphological interpolations. There is only one generic equation. The second equation that we have seen for binary interpolations. That second equation we are actually taking if x and y are the source and target. We are taking them like this, right? So this one we are dilating, and x union y we are eroding it. So entire thing we are taking the intersection, and finally we are writing them as the union, and this is what is the generic equation for the case which was shown like this. Same equation would also work for this. But here in grayscale, they are not just black and white pictures. It is not just a theme and no theme region. And we have multivalued information, as I always show in a simple matrix form with some values, let us say 64, 66. 71, 31, some 68, 28, 29, and 66, 66, and let me say some 52. So, I will call this as the function f of x y. To each x y positions, we have the values here, right. I also have, let us say, another function. I will call this as f I, another function probably with let us say this is f j. So, like source and target, and we have x and y is shown here, and now my source is f I and target is f j. So, between f I and f j, can I create earlier I called it as morphological median element, and I will call this here as a morphological median function, where can it be really applied? And suppose you have a population density data, grid wise population density data of let us say census of 1990 for a specific area. You have also the grid-wise population density data for 2001 census. So, we may not require to exactly find out what should have been the population density during 1995. But using these two things, because population density values from grid cell to grid cell, it gets varied. Then it is no more thematic information, it is not just black and white information, but it is with some multi-value, you have variations. So, between such things and how do you really compute the interpolations? So, it is again I will put this functions like this, there is one function like this, I call it as fi, and there is another function like this, another function like this. So, this is fj. So, these are actually the two landscapes, one dimensional landscapes, and a possible interpolated thing over a period of time fi has been transformed into fj. So, probably the time interval was some let us say 10 years, and you need to find out a kind of median landscape by taking fi and fj as the source and target. For such cases, a typical the median landscape would look like this. A median landscape would look like this. Right, but actually this is actually the string that I have taken from fi and fj. You just assume like that. And then what are the parameters required here? So, like intersection, and I will take infima, and like union, I will take suprema, and then like B, I will take flat B, just like the B that I have taken all through, and this can also be taken as a G, which is a structuring function. And with that we can write an equation like the median between fi and fj, median between fi and fj is fi infima fj, you dilate this with nb, and fi suprema fj, you erode this with nb, and then for these things you take infima, and finally you take suprema for all n values. That is it, this is the equation. So, what is the infima between fi and fj? It is point wise minimum value. Typically for fi and fj, the infima is 6471, let us say this is like this, 6471 it is 64, 6662 it is 62, 7112 it is 12, point wise minimum you are computing. So, 319 it is 9, 6863 it is 63. Like that you take the minimum values and 51. Similarly, you can also compute suprema values, which is the point wise maximum, that is 71, 66, 71, 31, 68, 46. 51, 52, and 66. You write this as fi infima suprema fj. But performing these dilations and erosions on infima you are performing dilation, on suprema you are performing erosion. Now you look at these two things. The typically the infima is of those two functions is actually the point wise minimum you are considering. This is the so this is fi infima fj, whereas so this is point wise maxima. So this is how you have taken, this is fi infima suprema fj. So you are eroding this and you are dilating the infima, and where exactly they are meeting, and you are trying to take that as infimum, and then for all n values you are doing that process, and then you are saying whatever wherever it reaches to the convergence and you will stop that. So what is the convergence criteria here, where exactly we need to stop? And the moment area, becomes greater than or equal to area of fi infima fj, fj, yes, this is where you stop it, yeah, which means this is like this, yes, yes, this is where we stop it. Every time you just make the comparison. So, is it the area of this is larger than the suprema of fi and fj? If it becomes larger, and then you just stop that process. And here we can also find out, as it is this is a kind of function, but when you put this that minimum n, and you can tell that there exists a distance between this process and this process. So precisely what you are doing is, and this is the infima, you are keep on dilating that infima, you dilate it and you take the area under that, and the moment that crosses the area of this, and you will stop that. That is the termination criteria, right? Until then you do this process, and then finally you take the suprema of all those things and you get a median. But the exercise what I give you is, you take this fi and fj, take this as fi and fj, and we have already computed infimum and supremum, and taking these two things, and what would be the first cycle of erosion, what is the first cycle of dilation, and then the infima of those first cycle of erosion from here and first cycle of dilation from here, you save it as an output, and then second cycle of erosion on this, second cycle of dilation on this, take the infima, and that is another output. Like that we go, and every time we find out whether this this property is satisfied halfway, and then we stop it there. Take all the outputs, and the suprema of all those outputs is the median between this and this. Suppose if you have an elevation model, so between an episode to episode, if you have incessant rainfall and there will be variations in the elevation structure. So, such effect of exogenic process, we call anything that comes from the weather related is exogenic process. And is there a variation in the elevation structure, elevation model or landscape elevation? And you have before the episode happened and after the episode happened, and you have two DEMs. And you want to really see, is there a significant change that has happened? If there is no change, and infima and suprema would be the same. Now, you just visualize what is the median between Fi and Fi. So, that is the median between these two itself, it is the same. It is the case of the thing that we have seen it here, and intersections are equivalent to unions. Here, infimum infima is equivalent to suprema, right. But if there is even a small minor subtle change, and you can really create a kind of grayscale interpolation to say that this is the place where there is an changes. But if you really want to study, you know, change detections, powerful change detections are actually coming from not from optical remotely sensed data, but from, you know, the microwave remote sensing data. They had wonderful techniques called interferometry, radargrammetry. So, actually they generate the interferograms, radargrams, and those interferograms would tell you where exactly the change happened. One example, if you get a chance, look at Howard Zupker's page. Howard Zupker, he is a professor at Stanford University. He works both at Pangea and Electrical Engineering Department. So, there was a Landers earthquake several years ago. He has taken SAR interferometric pictures before the Landers earthquake and after the Landers earthquake. He has shown the shifting of the Landers that fault for 15 centimeters, high precision. So, such precision we cannot get from, you know, optical remotely sensed data. So, again, interferometry is a very powerful geometric technique. You want to see the variations. Let us say you take a steel plate and you heat it up, and you may not feel the difference in the before heating and after heating, but if you really construct a interferogram and you can see the minor variations there, very conspicuously you can see that. So, but you have seen some very significant perturbation has altered the structure, and but you don't have the time sequential pictures. You have two snapshots. One example I'll always give is a oil slick. So there was an oil slick because of some ship has released the oil, or because of some accident the oil was actually occupied the shoreline and the waters. That oil slick is like a rubber sheet floating. So, it was a study while we were I was working in Singapore University, and this oil slick, when it gets completely vanished. So, this goes like, you know, a rubber sheet, and it does not stay at one place, but because of the ocean currents and all that, it gets stretched, squeezed, and all that would happen, and finally, it gets disintegrated and then they flow away. So, that process, and if there is a satellite taking that pictures at a different, which is getting shifted. So, can that be really shown as a simulation? So, initially it happened here, and over the days, and with stretching, squeezing, it got disintegrated and finally, it vanished. So, for all that, how much time does it really take? So, can we really make a prediction? And this is what we were used to be asked by the government of Singapore. Every day we have to give a report that, oh, this is the environmental condition today. But that was not an easy task, because one is acquisition process. other one is once you acquire it properly, and then other things probably we can just at least bring the results and the conclusions to the convincing way. For such kind of studies, these interpolations would work fine to create. After all, what we are doing, you have the source and you have end result. What happened in between, that is the challenge, find out. But you have this information, can you predict what is going to happen next? So that is even more a big challenge, right. For those things, you can try it as a simple exercise. Do this, generate one median function, and then between that median function and this one, you create another median, and until this gets satisfied.
So what is the value of B?
B, you take just a flat B with this type of B you take, but there would be a problem here. When I say that this is distance, suppose fi is like this, fj is like this, fj is like this. The suprema of these two is fi itself. Infima of fi and fj is fj itself. With flat, there is some danger. With flat structuring element, as you keep on dilating the flat one, at one level it becomes flattened. As you keep on expanding, eroding this suprema, it sometimes it may not come down to this level, but it may get saturated here. Just imagine here, there is a lowest value 28 here. In the process of repeated erosions, when all the grid cells are filled with 28 and beyond that, there is no point doing the erosion, because that has reached the convergence. In the same way, when you dilate this recursively, the moment all the grid cells are occupied with 71, that is the global maximum, and beyond that, there is no dilation happens. So, but when we are trying to find out the distance to try satisfying this property, we face a problem. Like before reaching to satisfy this property, so this thing will get converged and this thing will get converged. And then what is the distance? So I was asking my PhD student, who is a pure mathematician, oh, that distance is infinite distance. That's what he said. But he has a proof for it. But for an engineer, it is highly, you know, unconvincing. How do you say it? I am showing the proof. But to understand that proof, and my mathematics knowledge should go much beyond the levels. Anyway, but that happens with when B is flat. But if you take B as non-flat, that problem won't come. Which one? Radius of curvature. This one. It also depends on overall structure, and but at few times we will see when we deal with B. So then it was actually discarded by someone. Why do you want to use B as a flat? Don't never ever use B as flat. So the argument was, why I shouldn't use B as flat? He said these are the problems, but these problems I have not seen everywhere when I am using flat B. But when I have run some simulations, the transition between time step to time step is very smooth when I have used B as flat than B as non-flat. So these are the arguments, but unless we prove it with so many supporting results, and some people, you know, editors and reviewers, they may not agree. So, with this, I will just show you some results. Okay, you can go through this abstract and all that. So, the main objective was to transform source grayscale image into target grayscale image. to generate a sequence of grayscale morphological medians hierarchically between the source and target grayscale images as groups to generate morphing like transformation. And this works fine if you have a portrait of me and a portrait of Rajendra. If my face has to be metamorphosed into his face, so that can be easily done with either with flat B or a non-flat B. So that is called metamorphosis in the language. You have seen these equations. So infima between Fi and Fj is this is how it is calculated point-wise. Minimum, the top equation, point wise maximum is the second equation. The median between Fi and Fj is we take at each nth level median elements Fi and Fj, and then we take the suprema of all those things, where you have seen these equations. And if you are using a flat B, you will follow this notation, and if you are using the non-flat B, that is the structuring function, the bottom most equation will be used. And then actually this is the algorithm, so which I have already explained. The first step talks about consider Fi and Fj as the two spatial fields between which the morphological median needed to be computed. The second one is the register Fi and Fj by choosing appropriate control points such that Fi and Fj are with similar image specifications. The sense, if you are taking the image of a specific region at two different scales, one is at final resolution, at another one is at the coarser resolution, they are actually of the two different specifications. You need to actually register those two things before going for this approach, which is actually a limitation, which is a limitation. Then compute suprema and infima, the third step. Fourth step, dilate the infima for n cycles and that is what is shown in the fourth step. Fifth step, erode the suprema for n cycles. Sixth step, compute the infima between the eroded cycles and dilated cycles. The seventh one is to compute the area of the median and denote it as area of that particular median function. Repeat steps 4 and 7 through 7 for different n values until the area of that median function becomes equivalent to the area of the subsequent median function, which means there is no further scope to insert one more median between the, in the eighth step you can see those two notations. So the moment the area becomes equivalent and you will stop that, that is one criterion. So, step 9 is take the suprema of the median function for all n values and denote it as the median of Fi and Fj. So, by replacing the flat structuring element B with non-flat structuring element in the above 9 steps, one can generate morphological median with respect to G. So, this is the algorithm. And then you will understand what all that I have been explaining here. You have the A and B are these two spatial fields. So, then infima and suprema are shown, and then generation of morphological medians. Yes, this is where instead of really trying on this what I have mentioned here, and you can just take these two spatial fields and then how I have generated a morphological median, one morphological median between the spatial fields shown in A and B with flat and with non-flat. These two pictures would talk about it. So, that is figure 5 and figure 6. So, this is we have done on a cloud patch, and because we did not have the realistic clouds to really compare, we have this particular cloud pattern taken from MODIS satellite data. Its grayscale convex wall was constructed, and we wanted to show the how its geometry would vary. That is just for a kind of toy model we have shown it. And now you look at here, there are two elevation models. This belongs to the Selangor region, the other one is Penang region. So, actually the two regions in Malaysia. So, this was taken as a source and that was taken as a target. So, the idea was to slowly transform this source into the target using this morphological interpolations. So, we have the possible medians that could be computed between the source and target by using flat and by using non-flat were given. And then, okay, what else is required is thematic morphing you have seen, and then functional morphing, this is actually the functions, how source can be transformed in target. But 3D morphing is even more interesting. If you want to see volumetric way and how an object has been metamorphosed, so it requires you have to take some stacked information and then you have to visualize it. And then for that particular at surface transformation, the source and target DEMs, from this and this, the topmost source and target, the median was the second row. So between this median and the source, this is the median. Between this median and the target, there is another median, that is in the third row. Like that, it was hierarchically generated. And then this is where I was arguing the flat has actually given better result than non-flat, but there exists a danger that with flat and sometimes, you know, it may not meet the criterion. Halfway you will be confused, should I stop or should I further proceed? So that has been a tricky thing that is yet to be addressed properly. Yes, I think with all this I will show some morphing things. Look at here, morphing with flat B of level 3. What is level 3? Zeroth level is taking source and target, I have one median, that is 2 power 0, there is one median. The first level is between source and median, and median and target, I have 2 power 1, there are two medians. The second one is I have 4 medians and 8 medians. The third level is actually with eight medians. Wow, not this. I will see. This is also slightly distorted, but so from source to target there were only 8 median functions in between, including the source and target there are 10 pictures here, right? And then that is with flat structuring element, and with non-flat with non-flat, I have this. So here also the same number, but the structuring element we used was non-flat. And then if I go to fifth level, 2 power 5, you have so many median functions that could be generated, and it takes slightly more time for the transformation, that is with flat, and this is with non-flat. This is with non-flat, and if I go for eighth level, there are many. That is 2 power 8 median functions we could generate. But if you have historical data, for several thousands of years, and you can really show the complete what exactly happened within a span of 1,000 years to the landscape structures. So that can be really studied using these things in a discrete time and discrete space. This is with then one last thing I'll show with this. Yeah, this also is slowly transforming. Yeah, I think I should stop here. There are very minor changes here. I will again try, which didn't open yesterday. No, this wrong. These are slightly different ones about generation of fractal landscapes. Generation of fractal landscapes. So, if I can create some exaggerations and you can create landscapes. These are purely for, you know, graphics purpose. But can we really create an actual landscape? Yes, there are procedures, but it requires some basic inputs from actually the geometric structure. I have assigned forcibly some colors, but if you assign some shades here and if you create some exaggerations, and you can see them as nice things there. Now let me go back and what else is there. Some of the landscape pictures that I have shown here. Yeah, these are the typical landscapes, these two landscapes. So, but the source basic information for that is the actual skeletal network. And I think that's all. So if you want to go through some other more detailed work, so this we have edited spatial information retrieval analysis reasoning and modeling. So this was the special issue that I have edited with John Serra out of the conference we have organized in 2009. So anyway, I leave this information, and I think you can take these files. And then, so this is, if you really want to venture into morphology research, I would recommend you to go through this special issue. So, all most advanced topics are there, like graph morphology, adaptive morphology, and geodesic active contours. So, some of the topics on GPU based technology, how the speed of these transformations can be enhanced. This was again on the 70th birthday of John Serra, who have released this special issue. So, this one is I do not really recommend to read this book, but read Pierre Swall's book, so on morphology. But if someone has interest in to go through it, and I have already covered most of that information. So, these are some of my recent students and workers. With that, I'll stop, and you can ask me any questions.